Y254. Imagine.
Back on air, this is the Touchline on Y254. My name is Maxwell Wasike. Duncan Kuri, also known as Sugar Ray, former international boxer and communications officer of Boxing Federation of Kenya, is our guest this particular afternoon. He's joining us to tell us what you know the Boxing Federation of Kenya is doing and all matters resumption of sporting activities in the country. You are telling us off air about, you know, how the team is training at the state of the art, you know, AV Fitness Launch,
yeah.
A facility that belongs to my good friend Kentrack, who is also, is he still the chair of Nairobi branch?
Yeah, he is, the Nairobi County Boxing Association chairman.
How is the progress like in terms of the national team training ahead of the Olympic set for next year after postponement?
The gym is a fantastic facility, one of the very best in the country, and the boxers are really enjoying themselves. They are doing things that they have never done before.
Sure.
Because the kind of facility that we have in AV Fitness Gym is very different to what we have in our normal gyms in the estates. Because when you go to our estate gyms, the only equipment you might get is just a punching bag and some old gloves. But at the AV Fitness Gym, you have every kind of facility required to be physically fit. And so the Boxing Federation of Kenya has ensured that the boxers get the best training environment, and we want them to be in top shape when they go for the international assignments that we are having remaining before we go for the Olympic Games. And to start with, I think this is about the 8th week the team is training, and they train thrice in a week. But because we have an assignment, we want to go for a pre-Olympic qualifier tournament in Tanzania, Mabingwa. So I know the coach is going to change the program so that the boxers can engage on a weekly basis. That is 5 times in a week. Though, we still have a challenge because our sport is still considered contact sport. And when the Minister for Sport was reopening sports, she did not reopen boxing, among other sports, because we are contact sport and there's that risk of COVID. So what has happened is that we are trying to see how we can engage, because the kind of training that we've been doing is strength and conditioning, not going boxing specific, where we don't do sparring, we don't do pad work. And when you're going for a tournament, you need to do sparring so that you are, you know, you can have that sharpness. Because in boxing, somebody hits you on the face and you need to have that sharpness of trying to avoid. You can react very fast to avoid a punch. But if you're not doing that practice, then it becomes very difficult. So we need to get in touch with our colleagues from the ministry and we see if we can be exempted to be able to do some of the boxing specific kind of training which we require to be able to prepare our team fully, so that when you go for the pre-Olympic qualifier tournament in Tanzania, we can be able to be at our best. And I'm hoping that we must bring home the overall title of being the champions for Mabingwa 2020. But again, I'm very cautious because I'm seeing very worrying trend in terms of COVID numbers. They are going up and up. And if by the time we are getting to December, the numbers will still be this high, then I'm thinking it's a threat to even the tournament itself, because we cannot be able to go and participate in a tournament environment when the numbers of COVID are going high and high every day.
But we're just hoping for the best ahead. We look forward to God intervening and probably the numbers start decreasing. And I know that brings us to the question where we've been emphasizing to our fellow Kenyans that they should continue observing laid down containment measures put in place by the government through Ministry of Sports. So how is the operation of Boxing Federation of Kenya under President Jamal Ombok Otieno? Has it been like transition, of course, complying with Sports Act, the name changing from Boxing Association of Kenya to Boxing Federation of Kenya, and, you know, new secretariat, new leadership at the helm. How are things?
I think things are very different. Maybe the boxing lovers or the those in the sporting fraternity can be able to tell you that we are doing things a bit different.
How different?
In the previous administration, personally, I was not in the federation. But this time round, I'm in the federation, so I'm able to give you all the information you would require about what is going on. And we have really organized ourselves. To start with, we've had two international tournaments. We had the Africa Games 2019, which were held in Rabat, Morocco, where we got 5 medals. Then we went for the Olympic qualifier in Senegal in the month of February, and we got 4 medals. So in 2 tournaments, we have gotten 9 medals. That is a major improvement because previously the team was not doing very well. And you need to note that we have not changed the boxers. It's the same boxers who were there before, but now we have given them a more conducive environment, wonderful management by Team Jamal, and the results are showing themselves. And we have even gone a step further now that I'm telling you, the team is training in a state-of-the-art gymnasium in heavy fitness. So I'm hoping going forward, the results are going to get better and better. And Africa, we are going to reclaim our place in Africa as the top boxing nation in Africa.
Even the push from sporting federations locally to the government to reopen up sporting activities in the country to ensure that sports resume across the country. We've seen Football Kenya Federation writing to the ministry to, you know, facilitate the approval of that promotion playoff between Vihiga FC and Kisumu All-Stars, even Kenya Basketball Federation being given a go-ahead to ensure that, you know, Team Morans, the Kenya Morans, the national basketball men's team, start training ahead of Afro Basket qualifiers. I don't know, would you subscribe to that? Do you buy that narrative that, you know, sports should resume in its entirety?
It's tough. You know, it's a tough balancing act by the ministry officials because at the end of the day, the health of the athletes matters a lot and should always be given top priority. So the ministry has to balance the risk that is involved when people are engaging in sporting activities vis-a-vis the spread of the coronavirus. So I'm thinking probably if people put up adequate measures, the protocols, because I have seen one like when Harambee Stars was playing against Zambia, all the players when they were getting into the camp, they were tested so that you ensure everybody who is in that camp environment is somebody who has been tested and they have been found to be negative. Then you are operating within a bubble. So if this sporting discipline which wants to be reopened can be able to create an enabling environment where they are able to contain the spread of virus within the environment where the players are operating, I think the government can consider to give them permission to operate that way. And again, also now it also means when it's a game environment, then you operate without having fans, just like we have seen happening during the UEFA Champions League, Europa Cup, where teams are put in a bubble. Even the NBA, it happened, the teams were put in a bubble and they are working from there. No people coming from outside into where the players are. And that way, I believe it's manageable. But if people operate the way I'm seeing members of the public behaving, I believe it's very dangerous because I saw a very large crowd in Kisumu when the president and
the former prime minister
were in Kisumu. And I thought that was very dangerous. And I think the opening area, they were launching the construction of a stadium. I saw the kind of environment which I think is very, very dangerous for the members of the public because we still need to observe the government measures, which are the issue of social distancing, having masks. Some very few people had masks, but there was zero social distance. It was encouraging to see the president was having a mask, which is good. But now the people are the problem. So we need to be able to contain that kind of environment so that the people who are maybe in the environments where the sportsmen are, their safety can be assured before.
But Sugar Ray, you and I will agree that in estates, at the village level, in grassroots, sports is taking place. People are playing and the crowds are full to the capacity. Yesterday I was catching a floodlight action in the estate where, you know, a few rugby players were playing against each other to try keep fit, some of them coming from the national team, Leonard Mugaizi, Samson Onsomu. And, you know, the spectators are very cheerful. People are passionate about what is happening. I don't know. Should we just go full throttle and open up, Ban?
No, you know one thing. What our Minister for Health has been telling us, if you treat this disease normally, it will treat you abnormally. And like they say, ignorance is no defense.
Yes.
So the Ministry of Health has given us the right measures to follow. They have warned us enough. I think they're also getting tired. But the people, the members of the public somehow are lowering their guard. I think there is fatigue of observing these measures. But the problem is, if you listen carefully, you'll hear noises. The hospitalization is increasing. The number of people getting infected with this virus is going up every day. And sometimes, and I also believe you're not doing adequate tests. Because, for instance, today I just learned that America registered the highest number ever, which was 83,557 in a day.
Ahead of
so
the
that
elections.
Shows you they are doing almost 100,000 tests in a day, which is almost what we have done all through, because I believe our numbers are about 40-something thousand. So considering our tests are not the best and we have those high numbers, then it shows you that the virus is out there spreading to the people who are engaging in some of these activities. And it's sad because sometimes it takes a few deaths or the death of a person that you know for people to be convinced that indeed this virus is a risk and it's a danger. So my concern will be we really need to balance opening up and containing the virus, because if we continue treating this COVID pandemic situation as if everything is normal, I think it's going to mess with a lot of lives, which is not good.
Now, let's talk about the letter that has been written by Football Kenya Federation, signed by CEO Barry Otieno, to the government to give them a go-ahead so that, you know, the promotion playoff between a team that finished 16th in KPL last season, that is Kisumu All-Stars, playing against a team that finished third in National Super League, that is VGFC, a team that you are also, it is assistant chairman, of course, deputizing Kahindi Muli.
Yeah.
Are you in support of the federation that, you know, the playoff should happen very soon, because I think the league is likely to kick off in November 20th?
Yeah, I saw the letter, and it's addressed to the principal secretary in the Ministry of Sports. Yes, I'm in support that probably they need to be given permission to hold that match, like they have stated in the letter, in a COVID-controlled environment.
Yes.
Where players are going to be tested before the match from both teams, and there will be no fans. So I believe that way it's manageable.
The way the friendly between Kenya and Zambia happened at Nyayo National Stadium.
Exactly. So I'm thinking in that kind of environment, they should be allowed. But the organizers need to be to ensure that they strictly follow what they have written in that letter, so that when that approval is gotten, it's not abused. So I would hate to see an environment where you promise one thing, then you deliver something different. So to me, I think it's proper if they can be able to be given that permission, they hold that one match. And so it sorts the matter of the other fixtures when the league starts. Because I saw also they released a fixture for the league, and where Vihiga and Kisumu All-Stars are indicating it's not specific which one amongst the two will go through. So I think it also sorts some issues, because you need to be certain which team will be going.
Yes.
To participate in the league, in Premier League next season. So in that sense, I think it's the right thing to do.
The right thing to do. Let's speak about what happened last weekend, a day like today. On Saturday at the Kasarani, at the Safari Park along Thika Road, elections of FKF happened after back and forth, you know, a game of musical chairs.
Yeah.
Sports Disputes Tribunal gave the FKF Elections Board, led by Kentis Tikola, a go-ahead to hold the elections, which happened. Nick Mwenda was spectacularly re-elected against his opponents. I don't know. What do you make of the process? What do you make of his second tenure in office?
I think, when you look at the election, the way it went, it looked more like it was a formality. Nick had a very huge, there was a big difference between number one, I think 70 something was against five, who was number two. So basically I think it was a formality. Nick was going to defend his seat, which he did. I'm a bit concerned that the Registrar of Sport had written to the Federation highlighting some of the things that they had not followed, even though the Sport Dispute Tribunal ruled against that. I'm concerned because whatever position the Sports Registrar was giving is what is stipulated in the law, in the Sports Act. And FKF seems not to have followed strictly the law the way it is in the Sports Act. And I'm aware that when you do elections, you file your returns with the Sports Registrar. So I'm not sure whether they have already filed the returns to the Sports Registrar, and I don't know what will be her opinion. But it's a cause for concern in case you, as a federation, you do not comply with the existing laws, it becomes a problem because we need to lead from the front, we need to set good examples. The election, it was long overdue because it had been it has been suspended a few times, but I'm concerned about the aspects that the Registrar of Sport had risen, which were not met.
And that brings us forward to the point of where several sporting federations local haven't complied with Sports Act of 2013. You guys did.
Yeah, we were among the first federations to comply with the Sports Act. And for the record, even our election in the boxing fraternity, they were suspended three times by the registrar until we complied with some of those things that she's talking about. And they're very serious thing because we need to have those integrity documents for the officials who are at the county level. And we had a serious hitch with that because when we wanted to do our first election, and you go and notify the registrar that you want to do elections, then she advises you through a letter. And she writes those letters very politely saying, I'm proposing. And you have to obey what she says. So we could not defy what she did, and it was very helpful for us.
But you see, me laughed at that verdict by, you know, John Ohaga led Sports Disputes Tribunal. People said football has won because it was long overdue, just like you indicated.
It's because there's that fatigue, because you're trying to...
And a lot of assignments ahead, the qualification, you know, for the national team.
Everybody expects sports to resume.
Sure.
So they want people to go to the stadium to play football. But you see now the problem is the leadership of the federation is not complying with the existing laws. That is where the
problem. How hard is it to comply?
It's not very hard. If you just do your homework well, you comply very fast, because the officials at the county level, you just do this integrity. Although it's not that easy as it is, as somebody say, you know, when you say it on paper, it seems easy. But when you go to the grassroots, you know, us, when you're doing our elections, we were told to go back and do what now FKF had been asked by the registrar. Then those people, when you're going to look for those integrity documents, you find there are people who take these loans through the mobile apps. Then you go to CRB, they're telling you these people have debts which have not paid. You have to go and clear them.
On their behalf.
KCB, M-Pesa, Sijuitala, all those. We have very many people who want this leadership position at the county level, and they don't have those integrity documents. We had a serious challenge trying to clear all those, and they delayed our elections. Like I've told you, our elections were cancelled three times before we complied. So I'm thinking it's the way to go. We have to ensure that the people who are leading our sports, they have their integrity issues sorted, so that we are clear that we are having the right people leading our sport. Football is the most loved sport in the country. There's no doubt about that. Only that we need to have our house in order at the top, so that we can be able to manage the sport as well as the public expects of us.
And I think these requirements being put in place by the relevant authorities to be complied upon are not punitive, and they are for the good of the game. Isn't it the case? Because
definitely,
we saw what happened with CAF licensing requirements, where clubs were supposed to meet some conditions before being eligible to continue playing in top tier.
Yeah.
So Sofapaka and Moroni Youth being disqualified because they had failed to submit some documents, you know, briefcase clubs, not having an office, a secretariat, you know, even accounts for those clubs not in existence.
Mm.
It's good for the game, right?
It's very good for the game, and we're just trying to professionalize sports management in the country.
Yes.
So I'm thinking that's the way to go. Even other federation can borrow a leaf from what was happening in football, with trying to professionalize how clubs are managed. Because when you come to this other discipline also, you'll find the same issues apply, where we have clubs which operate in a very unsustainable manner.
You will depend from, is everyone. Is
you will be depending on handouts from maybe politicians to go and honor matches.
No self-sustainability.
And I just saw a classic case where you before we started this show, Shabana FC.
Yes.
Shabana is a classic case where they were doing very well. Then sometimes the money stream stops coming and the team's performance goes down. You end up not getting promoted to maybe the Premier League. And somehow players that just, you know, you're just surviving. And this also applied to the major clubs, FC Leopards and Gor Mahia. When they don't have sponsorship, that's how they operate. So you find it's not sustainable, but we need to professionalize our clubs so that they are able to operate in a sustainable manner and they are properly managed, because they are also funds that they are given, and those funds need to be accounted for even by sponsors. So our I believe the Sports Act came for the betterment of the sport in the country. I don't understand why most of the federation were resisting, and still some seem to be resisting up to now. But I think if we all go that route of trying to professionalize our sports, we are in the right channel and we are going to have our sport as one of the top industry in the country, because there's no doubt sport is one of the top industry in the country employing youths.
Still sticking with matters football, Jacob Ghost-Mulee is back at the helm of the national team as Harambee Stars tactician. Now, this being his fifth stint, and of course, you know what happened a few days before he took over. We were told that Francis Kimanzi and his entire technical bench parted ways with the FKF on mutual consent.
Yeah.
And, you know, even the scribes have been putting it in quotes. Mm-hmm. First of all, are you impressed with Ghost-Mulee's comeback?
I don't know. To me, it's good, because I believe as a country, we need to give our local coaches an opportunity to handle our national teams, because they are just as qualified as some of those guys we get from out there. And so when we give them an opportunity to handle our national team, I believe it's right way to go. It's a thing to do. And what I'm concerned about is what you are telling us about mutual agreement, which I think you're also disappointing us, because you should have investigated for us and tell us what exactly is this mutual consent.
That is
it mutual right as now. By the federation, or is does Kimanzi has a different
wish.
Story? But all in all, Kimanzi is my friend, Ghost is my friend. I believe they are all qualified coaches, the top coaches in the country.
Sure, sure.
It's a coincidence they are all Kambas, and the president is also a Kamba. But I believe Ghost is going to do a wonderful job. He has been there before. I believe he did a good job when he was there in 2004, when he took us to Cup of Nations in Tunisia. And so there is no reason why he cannot be able to deliver if he's given the right environment, which he suggested during the unveiling that he saw that the environment is good. I'm hoping that good environment is sustained for the three-year contract that he has signed. And I believe he also has been given a few targets which he believes he can be able to achieve with the current team. He has suggested that he's not going to change the playing unit. He's depending on getting our professionals who are not able to come for the Zambia friendly match
because of COVID.
Yes, but I'm thinking if the COVID situation continues as it is now, he's going to have a challenge in getting some of those players, the likes of Olunga, who is on fire, the likes of Arnold Origi, Anthony Akumu. There's Johanna Omolo.
Johanna Omolo.
All our professionals, they're out there in Europe.
Marcelo.
Where at the moment...
Started.
Yes, yeah, started. But you see now, the problem is, the COVID situation in those countries where they are is getting to a point where they are going into lockdowns. So it might be very difficult to get those players to come to do international duty, because it means when they'll be going back, they are going to have to serve the quarantine period of about 14 days. And that means you miss a few matches, and the teams are not going to be very comfortable with that. So it will be interesting to see how Ghost-Mulee and the management is able to handle that situation to be able to get our professionals back. But I also think for the Cup of Nations, I think it's a bit manageable because I'm thinking we have already drawn with Egypt, Togo. Now we have Comoros home and away. And then from there, the one for the World Cup qualifier, first phase, where we are having Mali, Uganda, and Rwanda, is a bit tricky because on paper,
you say
Mali is
beatable,
but no, on paper they are ahead of us.
Yes.
Uganda and Rwanda are very beatable. So on a good day, we'll be able to do that. So when you look at that group, I think we can be able to move to next phase of the final World Cup qualifier. But I still maintain Ghost has to be given a conducive environment to manage the team.
Do you think it would be Nick Mwendwa's good legacy when he leaves office after 4 years to ensure that the team has qualified to both 2021 AFCON and also World Cup in Qatar in 2022 a year later?
No, like you said, the big promise that Nick had given us during when he was seeking his first term was the Qatar 2022. Then it seemed very far, but I think COVID has even shortened the calendar. Now it's so close and there's a lot that needs to be done. I believe we have the right talent. If we manage it well, we are able to achieve results, which can ensure that maybe our team gets to qualify for the World Cup. But somewhere I've heard other making a case that our women are likely to go to the World Cup before our men.
The starlets.
Yeah, the starlets. So they seem to be performing better than our male colleague. But I believe the talent is there. If it's managed very well, we can be able to achieve the dream of participating in the World Cup.
Let's talk about the stadia. Of course, as we get to the tail end of this particular show, you know, President Uhuru Kenyatta has said that, you know, the promise to construct several stadiums in various parts of the country is still on and they will honor the pledge. But here in Nairobi, even the county boss, Mike Sonko, has also been getting committed to the cause, saying that, you know, his earlier ambitious stadia plan where he promised to construct four of them, Kihumbwini,
yeah,
Ziwani, Dandora, and which one else that I'm forgetting, was on course until, you know, malice and politics entered the fray.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
I saw that clip where he was saying that, and what he was suggesting was that the national government thought he was going too fast.
Yes.
In terms of the promises that they had made, so that they try and check on him so that he doesn't achieve that before the government achieves what it promised people, which I don't know. I don't have other facts to say whether it's true or not. But I think we actually badly need to have the infrastructure, which are stadiums, to be able to give the youth to tap this talent that we have. There is massive talent in this country, but the infrastructure is somehow failing us. But I believe if the Jubilee met the promises that they gave us when they were being elected 2013, and by the time they are going out, they'll have delivered I think there are about nine stadiums, and Sonko is able to deliver his four. I think that will be a good legacy for them, because the stadiums are required by all counties, actually. I have seen one magnificent stadium which has been put up in Kakamega County. I've seen another good one in Kisii. So I'm thinking the county are doing something maybe to supplement what the government promised. But still, that is not an excuse. The government needs to deliver their end. The infrastructure are badly needed by youth. It's very difficult, like even to hold football matches, because Nyayo Stadium was closed for a very long time. Kasarani was undergoing renovation. City Stadium, it's a problem that needs to be addressed also there, because it's not in a usable state.
Yes.
So you find it's very difficult even when our football resumes. We don't have adequate number of playing stadiums. And I think it's a high time that the government works on delivering on the promises that were given, because that is one area which I believe the youth will not forgive them and will always remember.
Eliud Kipchoge eyeing a strong comeback After London setback, we all saw what happened to him in London, but of course he's still a champion and he's still glorified, not only by us, but even by the international athletic scene. He's the big man, world London record holder, 3 times London Marathon champion.
No, 4 times.
4 times. A man wear many hats indeed.
Yeah. Eliud is a real deal. It's only that he had a bad day in office in London.
Yes.
But I have no doubt that Eliud has got the capability of running a marathon below 2 hours. He has done it before, although the record was not recognized by World Athletics.
That INEOS challenge where he ran under 2 hours,
yes,
right?
Yes. So, but unfortunately, I have seen 2 world records broken with the assistance of those lights, Cheptegat.
Yes.
I don't understand why those ones are recognized and the ones for Eliud is not recognized.
Joshua, the Ugandan.
Yes. So he broke the 5,000 world record and 10,000 world record,
yes,
using assistance of those lights. The same thing that Eliud did. And I don't know why they did not recognize the one for Eliud, though he ran the same distance. But my belief is that Eliud is still the top marathoner in the world. And I'm looking forward to seeing him going defend his Olympic gold medal. I believe he still has the capability of breaking the world record in marathon. And I have no doubt that before he retires, he'll have lowered that mark further. Though I still think Kenenisa Bekele will provide a serious challenge to that record, because in Berlin last year he missed it by 2 seconds. So that shows you he has got capability of breaking the record. But I think also there was a distraction when they ran the London Marathon, because everybody was looking for a contest between Eliud and Kenenisa.
Yes.
Then Kenenisa,
it was tipped a two-horse race between the two before,
yeah,
Kenenisa
got
injured and
got injured, hamstring, and when he pulled out of the race, yeah, now people thought it was a walkover,
yes,
for Eliud. And they just thought it was a procession. Eliud is going to be coronated as the king of London, having won 5 times. It didn't happen. He had a bad day in office. But I still believe he's the top marathon
in the world.
He
can bounce back.
Not he can, he will. I believe he will bounce back, and he has not finished putting those records, because I believe he's still going to lower the world record, and he is very much likely to go and win the second Olympic gold medal, which will be historic because he'll be the first Kenyan to do that.
Your parting shot, what are your final thoughts on the way forward of Kenya?
The way forward, I think we need to be cautious as Kenyans. We need to be very careful in terms of putting our guards up. In boxing, we always say, protect when the referee tells you, protect yourself at all times. It means you put up your guard. So we know COVID is out there. We need to follow the government measures seriously. We need to wash our hands. We need to sanitize. We need to wear a mask. We need to follow social distance.
Do your boxers do that?
Yes, they do that. I told you, we are operating in a
world-class
environment.
And after that,
when they are getting to the gym, they come wearing their masks. By the way, our president has a designated vehicle for the boxers. They are,
wow,
picked from town and dropped at the gym, and picked from the gym, brought back to town. They are having their mask on. When they are entering the gym, they are checked their temperatures. Then they have to record a register on a daily basis in case there's an issue to do with contact tracing. The gym facility has adequate equipment such that there's no sharing of equipment. Of course, we advise them. We have our protocol where they don't share things like water. There's no entanglement in the gym where such that you can be able to pass.
That word is being popularly used nowadays.
Yeah. So we're trying to ensure that our boxers observe all the measures. And you remember the gyms were opened.
Yes.
It's only that boxing was not opened as a sport, but gyms were open. And coincidentally, boxing training happens in the gym.
Sure.
So we just took advantage of that situation and ensure that our boxers continue training in preparation for the assignments that we have, which is the Olympic qualifier, which is likely to happen in France in the month of May, and the Olympic Games, because we have 2 boxers who have already qualified for the Olympic Games. So it's just a matter of keeping our boxers physically fit and being ready when the sport is opened here officially. We start with a new calendar to see, because already our calendar has been disrupted seriously By now, we were supposed to be doing our fourth leg of the league and finishing maybe next month. But now the league has not started, so we are nowhere. But we are hoping for the best. The trend happening currently in the world is not the best. But nevertheless, we have to be prepared because, you know, they say if you fail to plan, then you're planning to fail. As you're planning to succeed.
Thank you, Duncan Kuri, also known as Sugare, coming on the show this afternoon to talk to us about way forwards on sports resumption, even as they push from various local federations on the government to open up sporting activities in the country. Continue, he says, from where he comes from as the Public Relations Office of Boxing Federation of Kenya, despite the fact that they haven't been allowed to go full throttle on training, they have resumed training in compliance with COVID, you know, protocols and containment measures put in place by the government of Kenya. Always a pleasure having you on board. Thank you, Sugare. Thank you for coming through.
Thank you.
Big up, man.
You're most welcome.
If you want me to listen, talk about boxing.
Yes.
Wow, that's a good one. Let's take a short break. We'll be coming back in a few with fans on Joe Saina, Maureen Mudhoni, already in the studio to take us through what is happening. Of course, Nigerian protest, plenty of it happening. We've seen footballers coming from Africa, Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang, Odion Ighalo, leading the front to push the government to stop anti-police protest. Of course, that forming the basis and much more lined up, a lot of fixtures, pulsating clashes, El Clasico, Manchester against Chelsea. How about we take a short break, then we will be back in a few.